Hello, welcome. This is Subhash Gatade. I'm associated with New Socialist Initiative, a left ideological political platform. I welcome you all for the 23rd lecture in the Democracy Dialogue series. Our guest today is Professor Manoj Kumar Jha, who is the Rajya Sabha MP, who will be talking on reimagining Jawaharlal Nehru today. I thank Manojji for that he accepted our invite to share his ideas despite his busy schedule. For me, it is rather difficult to introduce Manojji because he is such a well-known public figure. But a consistent votary of the idea of social justice and a strong opponent of the politics of majoritarian authoritarianism, he has been a national spokesperson of the Rashtriya Janata Dal, and his interventions in debates and discussions in the upper house of the parliament are very much discussed and debated. Secondly, he has been with the Department of Social Work for the last many years, and he was head of the department also, and is a very popular teacher in the university, and he has been taking candles on behalf of the teaching community. Today, in his lecture, titled Reimagining Jawaharlal Nehru Today, Professor Jha intends to examine independent India's first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru's legacy and contributions in the context of the present day, who played a crucial role in shaping the country's political, economic, and social landscape after its independence in 1947. The idea is to reimagine today, presuming Nehru was here, and have to look at our parliamentary democracy and the core policy issues which have undergone so much changes that he would disown. The idea is to speak about the critical concerns we face as a nation through the Nehruvian lens. Friends, please welcome Professor Manoj Kumar Jha.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Subhash Ji. Thank you, New Socialist Initiative. Thank you for this honor. And no need to thank me. Rather, I should apologize that this was going on, the discussion was going on with Subhash Ji for very long. My mother is not well. She is still not well. And because of her, I had to reschedule a lot many engagements. She is undergoing chemotherapy every week. So I must apologize. This could have happened in the month of May itself, when the month Nehru was born. But because it is all about reimagination, I can see Aditya Ji also and so many other friends, it becomes very difficult to share my share of reimagining Nehru with you all. Because all of us do that reimagination, if not through our writing or through speaking, maybe while we are going to bed, we reimagine if Nehru was here, how would he have thought about it, or how would he have shaped or reshaped his politics. So I'll do all that, whatever little capacity I have or whatever little reading I have. But I must acknowledge my reading of Nehru at a greater depth. I must say thanks to Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. Because of him, I went back to the books I had already read. I reread things written by Nehru and written on Nehru. So, I should be fair in my acknowledgement. Thank you, Prime Minister. You made us revisit Nehru. That's number one, sir. Number two, the idea of reimagining Nehru came also because, since again 2014, almost on a regular basis, either on his death anniversary I must correct myself. I said May. May was the month he died. And November was the month he was born. So since 2014, almost every year, I have been writing a letter addressed to Nehru. Again, I must confess and acknowledge that this letter writing thing I borrowed from Nehru. I don't think we have a greater letter writer in our history, and forget our history, even in world history. He was amazing. So every year since 2014, and again, I'm going back to the fact that 2014, Prime Minister Modi took charge as Prime Minister of India. And every year, as I said earlier, I repeat, I used to write. I still write. I contemplate writing even before the next general election. The reason being very simple, that in all those letters, I engaged with Nehru, tried to engage with Nehru, Nehruvian ideas. And no, Nehruvian ideas are actually not very abstract philosophical kind of thing. If I have to borrow a term from Gramsci, I would say praxis kind of thing. Nehru, in fact, I would say that I'm not sure whether he had read Gramsci or whatever, but the fact is we get an insight into Nehru's writing and persona, his working style, a lot similar to the ideas of praxis propounded by Italian Marxist Gramsci. Now, what is this? I mean, when you want somebody dear to you to come back on earth, it is actually in the backdrop of painful memories of contemporary times. These painful memories, which pains you, which pains the nation, which pains people who looked at the architecture and the edifice of this nation through Gandhi, Nehru, Azad, they felt little like orphans, that where are we heading? So, and for them, their thought appeared to be a thought in the orphanage. So most of us, when we reimagine Nehru today, we try to come out of that orphanage where we have been pushed in last couple of years to see and probably have a sense that what Nehru would have done or would do if he comes back on the earth. In real life, there is no mechanism. People come back on earth, but imagination doesn't follow the grammar of real life. So I begin from here. Majoritarianism is something Nehru abhorred. And his writings, his speeches are testimony to the fact. If you look at the discourse during the partition or the exchange of letters between different political leaders, Nehru was very clear. He had no ambiguity. I would say probably he was the only one who had absolute clarity regarding the roadmap the independent India has to follow. That, what was that roadmap? In one of his speeches, say that whatever happens in the other side, that is the new born Pakistan, please, and this he said in front of Mahatma Gandhi, I will not allow this country to become Hindu Pakistan. That was his idea. He knew the inner pulses, even in the, at that time. Let's not be in a make-believe kind of world that everything was great and rosy in the years of partition years, either before or after partition. There was something fundamentally shifting in our public imagination, public discourse. Nehru was quite aware of it. And thus his position on majoritarianism had no ambiguity at all. There were people in the Congress who had ambiguous position. There were people in the Congress who, in whatever capacity they could do, they tried to bring roadblocks into the kind of politics Jawaharlal Nehru wanted India to usher. I must say that Gandhi did not quite share the worldview of Nehru. But Gandhi also at the core of his heart knew that the worldview of Nehru is the only antidote available to us with this kind of poisonous politics. And thus what happens? Gandhi actually, in the context of his proposed fast in Punjab, he said, don't do it. You have to work here. Hind ke Jawahar Banero. That emotional one line had a kind of message from Gandhi that I'm with you. in this kind of politics. So I today, when we look around us, it is interesting to note, and I think all my friends whom I can see, and I can tell you, why don't you see RSS or BJP attacking any other prime minister in that measure as they do with Jawaharlal Nehru? We have so many prime ministers. Nehru was the first one. Long died in 1964. Why is he being targeted every moment, every day? The fact is, Nehru is the great wall which does not allow them to decimate the idea of democracy, parliamentary democracy, and what we call that an electoral majority gained through election is not a license to usher into majoritarian politics. A distinction has to be made between majority in parliament and going ahead, going berserk with majoritarian politics. What we see today in our country is precisely what Nehru was afraid of. And I'll tell you here something. This disease has impacted many political parties traveling from the kitty of BJP and RSS. It was on 370, the day, and Kashmir was being turned into a union territory. That was one of the saddest days of my life. Another day being the farm laws when they were passed, and we found ourselves helpless. So in the corridor, in the gallery, Ketkar Sahab knows, in the gallery of Rajya Sabha, I heard some big leaders of all political parties, kare yaar, desh ka mood badal gaya. We must understand. We must not oppose it. You know, and then I wrote, because I couldn't keep it to myself. Subsequently, you see, now we find a political party which had a very different stand when state of Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir was dismembered and 370 was scrapped. Now the same political party has a different stand on the central ordinance. I don't want to go into it. But the fact is that if Nehru was there that day, he would not have cared. Or he would have cared for the mood of the nation, but he would have told us, look, mood of the nation can be changed. You engage, you talk without fear. That art which tells us to fight majoritarianism is a missing link today. And that's why we remember Nehru. Now, second, connected to majoritarian politics, because majoritarian politics, you know, it's almost like, well, how does it impact? It impacts not only parliament, which is a symbol of democracy. It also impacts institutions which support that symbol, whether it is media, whether it is academia, whether it is judiciary. I am not listing executive in this, because the executive is the one which began this process of majoritarianism. Now, this majoritarianism ultimately is going to impact very badly to the very idea of democracy. You know, there is no funnel in the EVM which stops dictatorial regime or majoritarian regime. The funnel is through different institutions. Those funnels are missing, as a result of which divisive politics has become the norm of the day. I mean, I remember recently, and all of you, because I don't want it to be only a theoretical thing, I'll tell you, I was watching Karnataka election. Even by his own standards, and I don't believe that PM has very high standards in public discourse. That's the proposition all of us know. But the day, in desperation or quite being very clear about it, where does he want Karnataka results to take, he went on to equate Bajrang Dal is equal to Bajrang Bali. That was another very sad day in the memory of India. Now, why was he tempted to do that? Because he had success stories of certain elections. And those elections told him that bread and butter have limited capacity. Unemployment as an issue, you must look for emotive issues. Now, in his scheme of things, the only emotion which gets drawn to election is either in the name of national security or in the name of gods and goddesses. You watch when they speak, they don't speak about core issues which define our everyday life. It was certainly not Nehru. He would not have, never have done it. Nehru got an India after independence, partitioned India. There was a different kind of passion moving in certain parts of this country. He had all the parameters, all the everything on his side. He could have become a dictator. Nobody would have stopped him. But he chose the corridors of parliamentary democracy, and without looking at the fact that majority is a license to get into a majoritarian kind of politics. Now, divisive politics, we didn't see of this scale even after partition. Partition brought, I think, distraught memories to people. If I take even Punjab and Bengal, the two areas which were impacted the most, even in these two areas, post-partition elections were never fought on these kind of divisive politics. This is something which is new to us, at the same time, which is followed by another, that is erosion of democratic institutions. You can take everything. Adit ji is here. My daughter is studying in JNU, and she comes and tells me that, Papa, it is no more the JNU you all knew. It's not only about JNU. It's about the very idea of university. Let's go back to media, another important democratic institution. What is happening to that? Can we, Subhashji, the kind of conversation we are having to hear today on a Zoom link provided by New Socialist Initiative, can any major political television channel, can do this exercise? Even for 20 minutes, they can't do. So the matrix has changed. Now, what worries us that erosion of democratic institution is also an ongoing process. There is I call it, long back when PM had not become PM, I was talking to a television anchor in a news show. I told PM is very good at managing coercive consent. Coercive consent. He brings coercive consent on the table and presented to the, when I say coercion, coercion is not only by arm twisting, by colonizing your mind, your cognitive frame, what you do, you achieve a particular kind of mindset. And that mindset allows you to break the rules of the game or provide new rules and telling that this is new India and these new rules shall work in India. So an accident becomes an occasion of celebration. An accident which in yesteryears would have drawn different kind of debate on safety, security of passengers, now it draws a different set of parameters which puts that in the on the back burner. I should speak the least on human rights issues. All of us have some friends, some students, some known people. They are in jail without reason. The other day I had gone to attend, Swazi told me, it asked me, where were you day for yesterday? That was 1,000 days of Omar Khalid's incarceration. One of my known students from Jamia is in jail. If you look at the charge sheet, that's copy-paste kind of thing. I mean, well, it reminds me of McCarthy years, that even if you have an idea here on your mind, and that somebody gets the idea that you have that idea in your mind, you are a potential candidate for a jail or suspension of your liberties. Now, what worries me not the government doing it, worries us all is the fact that the Prime Minister has consent for it, and the ruling party has a consent for it, whether in the name of religious national security or blah, 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 so many other things you can list. And you can say that, or even some political parties in the opposition would say that, look, the fact is the nation has changed. Your politics should be in the changed nation, without realizing that if you change your politics, bringing Mukti Bodh in this, Mukti Bodh would have asked, kya hai politics teri bhai? Now, so, and again, economic policy, I will not get into it, because if Nehru was here, he would have scolded the first liberalized, first Congress government which brought this liberalization, and under TINA, there is no alternative, let's go for it, structural reforms and so many other things, which almost sounds like oxymoron. So I would rather say that for Nehru, the idea of economic policy was integral to his persona, which is essentially democratic. And he time and again repeated that you have to democratize your economy. What did he mean when he spoke about democratization of the economy? Nehru today, if he had seen the Oxfam report, if he sees the Oxfam report from above, from heavens, that the scale of income disparity, income inequality, he would have been appalled that look what they have done. I mean, in a vast ocean of insecurity, poverty, hopelessness, despair, you have 5-6 islands of prosperity. Let's not call them crony capitalists for a moment. But in the scheme of Nehru, it would have, it doesn't fit in. And before I move on to the other aspects, I'll tell you. One day, I had a brief, in media terms, they called it altercation, but it was not, it was an argument. I had asked the MEA, Jayashankarji. I asked him plainly, Ketkar sahab was there that day in the house. I asked him, look, you say as if India's foreign policy was nothing before 2014. And everything is since then only. And my question was particularly in the context of Palestine. Because while Gaza was being bombed, my government did not give any statement. So he provided an answer, this thing has changed in 2014 and blah, blah, blah. Then I happened to see one of his statements recently, where he said, how can we challenge China? It's a very strong economy. It's a huge economy. Nehru would have slapped him. I mean, slapping shouldn't be considered as literal slapping, but he would have told him, my boss, resign kar do. If he was his MEA, he would have sought his resignation immediately. I mean, the very idea of non-aligned movement, if you look at it, what was it? The world was in two powerful lobbies. And a newly born nation, which was not a $1 trillion, $2 trillion economy, but we had the courage and the conviction that we spoke for the entire colonized world, whether political colony or economic colony. Do we speak that language? We don't. Why don't we speak that language? Because we don't have Nehru. What stops us from bringing Nehru in? Because the regime knows the only wall between its idea of making it the rhetorical Hindu Rashtra. The only challenge is not from the opposition, is from the Nehruvian ideas. Even in his death, Nehru stands upright. So every time they have to do something, if they have to put a sengol, they have to connect it. The Nehru received it. He put it somewhere else. Yes, boss, Nehru received it. He found it useless. In a democracy, a symbol of monarchy. So he put it at the rightful place. But now your politics demands you to bring back Sengol. Nehru, in order to understand his people, he did not need a Sengol to give a sense to these people that, look, I'm there for justice. People saw him and believed in him. People heard him and believed in him. That is personal inadequacy of our prime minister. And on a lighter note, I must tell you, there are two sets of people in our prime minister. One is a great Mughal. I mean, you can choose any Mughal ruler. And there is a sense of what we call imitation is the worst form of flattery. He tries to imitate Nehru, but he cannot imitate Nehru in terms of ideas, in terms of his conviction. So the easiest thing is to get a Nehru jacket and call it a Modi jacket. So I'll move from here. You know, talking about all Nehruvian ideas, if one has to see, I know the kind of people I'm talking to. I don't need to give these kind of details. You all know. It's just that let's reiterate. We should all read the objective resolution put forth by Nehru on probably December 13th, 1946, if my memory serves me right. Everything listed there, sovereignty, democracy, equality, fundamental rights, social justice, economic planning, international relations. It was a kind of collage, a beautiful collage of Nehruvian worldview, which was shaped by his colleagues. It was not an individual's brainchild. And while introducing it, he said something which is listed, which is there in the Constituent Assembly debate compilation. There is this reference to oath of the tennis court, and it pertains to French Revolution. The clergy, the nobility, and everybody, they were sitting together, but they were afraid. One room was probably snatched from their as their meeting place. They wanted to finish the business, and before finishing the business, they didn't go want to disband the meeting. So they moved on to an area called tennis court and took an oath that will not get up from here unless we finish this constitution, whatever in that form it was. It was called oath of tennis court, oath of the tennis court. And Nehru reminded the people that there could be a time when your dear ideas, your values shall be challenged. Be prepared to move to any place, face any challenge, take them in your stride, but remain committed. I think that is something which we have collectively forgotten. And I won't blame only the Prime Minister or the RSS or the BJP. As I said, and I repeat, Nehruvian idea of economic planning was decimated first during the 1990s, 1991. Ketkar Sahab is an exception. But I must tell you, 2014, Outlook magazine published a cover. And again, that was a very disturbing cover. It read, "Can Nehru survive Modi?" The only solace in that cover was a note of interrogation at the end. Can Nehru survive Modi? Nehru can survive anyone, any kind of onslaught. But there was conspicuous silence from most of the political parties. I mean, they thought, and many people mistakenly believe, I've said it in parliament, Nehru does not belong to Congress alone. He was a prime minister. Congress was the only national party at that time. He was the leading figure after Gandhi, Patel, I mean, this group. But he is a national asset. Congress has no copyright on it. But the fact is, many people did not know, even today, they don't know why Nehru be defended, why Nehru be remembered. Simply going to Shantivan doesn't help. Nehru is not in Shantivan. Nehru is in the idea of India. Nehru is in the structure and the processes that we're supposed to safeguard democracy. But very few people. I mean, when the demolition squad, literally a demolition squad, went down to demolish the idea of Nehru, you would find very few defenders. The reason being, most of the people actually have not cared to read about Nehru, to learn more about him. Anyway, sir, so I come to the other part. Now, let's presume Nehru comes back. Now I'm getting to the final part of it. If Nehru comes back, first of all, if he comes back, first he'll tell us very clearly, in no uncertain terms, that what have you done to strengthen democracy? How are you defending democracy? Why are you allowing this kind of discourse which believes democracy is only about election? Why don't you question? I mean, we have instances galore that on use of fair and fair means, there was a specific question to Nehru in 1952, the first general election, imagine. And he said, I would rather like to lose. And his kitty of fair and unfair included everything from money, muscle to divisive politics or divisive language. Nehru would have certainly asked us, what is your mark sheet in terms of strengthening democracy? Nehru would have today been very, very sad looking at the idea of or the state of secularism in this country. You know, Nehruvian idea of secularism needs probably much more rigorous academic work than what we have seen today. Nehru's secularism was certainly not, many people who wrongly call him a westernized secular, no, sir. He was an Indian secular. He was experimenting with the idea of Indian version of secularism, which should be seen only through the lens of Treaty of Westphalia. And look at Discovery of India. Just read those pages again. He was very proud of our heritage, our inheritance, in terms of diversity of religion, what every religion offered. And at one point he writes that, look, I have a different worldview while talking about scientific temper. But at the same time, I know the country I'm born in. I know what people think of karma theory and reincarnation. I have to sow the seeds of secularism, that is respect for each religion, in this soil. And he was fairly successful. If we did not have these kind of images, I would say, look at the fact how many communal rights we see from 47 to roughly 66, 67. Very few. Why suddenly we see a change in the frequency from 67, 72 onwards? And then let's not talk about what happens today. So I think Nehruvian idea of secularism also needs to be read and propagated at a greater level. Many people ridicule today through WhatsApp messages, differences of Nehru with Sardar Patel, differences of Nehru with Gandhi, or differences of Nehru with Subhas. There were differences. Nobody can deny. But we must also know there were differences of Nehru of 1920 and Nehru of 1940s. There was difference of Gandhi of South Africa and Gandhi of say Dandi March or Quit India, Bardoli, pre-Bardoli, post-Bardoli Sardar, or for that matter Subhas Babu Netaji. I mean, these, the very fact that if they were inconsistent, that is, they were genius. They knew how to overcome. They did it. The only fact is what today people do, cherry picking. When you cherry pick from historical events, you not only destroy history, you destroy the contemporary cognitive frames of millions of Indians. And that has been done very successfully because a very few of us countered that. We became silent. Or like I said earlier, that people said, look, boss, desh ka mood badal raha hai, vagera, vagera. Interestingly, I'll tell you, ek waqia abhi yaad aa gaya, isliye main bata raha hu. Nehru, Jawaharlal ji ne apni biography, autobiography bheji Amrita Shergill ko. Amrita Shergill ne kaha ki aam taur pe main biographies nahi padhti hu, autobiographies nahi padhti hu, kyunki log usme apne bare mein itna kuch likhte hain ki jadugar the, ye aata tha, wo aata tha, lekin aapki zarur padhungi. Because you are the one, when you visit a sea, you say, I saw the sea for the first time. You are not like those who say the sea saw me for the first time today. Aur ab walon mein ye dekhi, jo kare sabse pehla wahi kar rahe hain. To main ye keh raha hu ki Nehru aur Nehruvian ideas mein jo cheeze the issues which are very pertinent is strengthening democracy, as I said, then secularism. I think there has to be a repair mechanism, what Nehru would want us, retrieval mechanism. If we don't do, regime change won't help. Because I'm talking to you all in the month of June. Next year, we shall have a government. Either new or the old continues. If the new government is there, the new government has its plate full of issues and agenda. You can't say that these kind of things we'll do later when we come back to power. Boss, aisa nahi hota. There is a popular saying that I'll think about Christianity once I become the bishop. It doesn't happen that way. So I think Nehru would have told every citizen of this country, strengthen democracy, promote secularism. In your personal life, in your public life, religion is a matter of personal life. Be hugely religious. But when it comes to state and state policy, make sure that the state policy does not engage with, at a greater scale, with one religion and leaving aside other religions. Did we hear the word lynching in the entire phase of Nehru? Or even subsequently, now this is one word which comes almost every second day, third day. I mean, I don't think any Baba would have got that kind of, say, hello, which they are getting today. Why it is happening? Because the idea of scientific temper, which was very dear to Nehru, he would have been very, very critical about this issue also, if we reimagine him today. Now, the idea of science Congress, compare the speeches of Nehru and compare the speeches of the current Prime Minister. I remember, I think it was his first or second speech, where in the surgery kind of thing he was referring to, and he referred to Ganeshji. With all due respect for all the gods and goddesses, the fact is that why do you have to look for everything in the ancient text? And in order to say that, you look, we had this, look, we had that. No. Scientific temper means the spirit of inquiry, the spirit of questioning. What do we expect? He would have told us from a regime which has taken out the Darwin's evolution theory. The idea today is not to have discussion on evolution. Because evolved mind will question. And the regime doesn't like question. Nehru would have been certainly very, very powerful about it. Then I must also say that the idea of welfare, which Prime Minister many a time ridicules it by saying revdi, freaky revdi. I don't know who his script writers are, but they are not doing good to him, because he may not be a Prime Minister tomorrow, but these speeches shall remain in the public domain. And these speeches shall be a reason for many PhDs, subsequently many MPhil, many books shall be written, how not to be this kind of Prime Minister, how not to speak like this. Now, this is something where Nehru would have been very, very clear. And then the idea of, I won't say, repeat it, but as far as this issue is concerned, non-aligned movement or the very idea of foreign policy, I think he would have revisited all that. But the most importantly, I believe, what he would have done is to tell us that believe in yourself. Indian democracy has faced these challenges earlier also. Many of us become very, very hopeless and we go into despair. Friends, when we meet, we are told, look, kuch hoga, badlega kya? I repeat, regime change won't help. It's a huge battle. It's a battle not only to defend a memory, our national memory, is a battle to make sure that surgical implant of memory doesn't take place. They are trying to do that because a regime, a political party, a structure which had no contribution in the making and shaping of India, they have to locate a new history for themselves. The only way of locating a new history for themselves, Aditi ji, I must tell you, they would imagine counterfactual. Counterfactual imagination. I've written about it. You know, I have read some counterfactual histories. They look good as a fiction. They look good. They tell you that how, I mean, look at the imagination. Somebody imagines if Caesar had not crossed Rubicon. But in real life, if your counterfactual imagination replaces history violently, you are actually doing an irreparable kind of damage to the citizens, to the idea of citizenship, to history, to the idea of historical imagination, not only to the past, but also forgetting the present, even the future. Certainly, and last but not the least, I would, many things I thought, but I would just close it by saying India is a better, and after this I'll share a personal memory also. India is a better place to, I'm quoting Indra Malhotra. India is a better place to live in because Nehru lived, and no matter how long the babies born on the Diamond Jubilee of Independence live, they will never see the like of it. Ketkar Sahab, my date of birth is 15th November. In Parliament, wrongly, it is 5th of August. So I followed Nehru even dates. 14th, he was born. 15th, I was born. My father's name is Jawahar. Imagine that of age. I mean, I never saw him because I was born 3 years after his demise. But you know, every moment, when you are in crisis, your national life is in crisis, you remember Nehru. I mean, I think Nehru, more than Rahul ji, Priyanka ji, Sonia ji, Nehru belongs to us all. He's part of our family, the Indian family, the part of the family which propounds the idea of India, a family which sobs, which frustrates, which suffers. This is what Nehru has given to us. And when we reimagine Nehru today, he tells us, boss, meri politics jinda hai. Thank you, sir.
Bahut bahut shukriya. Many, many thanks, Manoj ji. Like your interventions and in the discussion in the parliament, this your brief talk is very illuminating, and I think I know that there are many things to be discussed. But and we have many illustrious speakers and students and scholars on Nehru studies. Aditya Mukherjee sahab is there, and Kumar sahab is there, and many others there. But before I invite them to share their views and ideas, I will request my senior comrade and friend Ravi Sina to say a few words, and then we will have the question and answer session. Ravi, please.
Thank you, Suhash, and thank you so much, Professor Jha, Manoj ji, if I can say, for accepting our invitation, and it's great to have you here. And of course, you know, we were expecting, and we got a typical Manoj Jha lecture, you know, so nice to have you here. We are really honored. As Subhash said, there are many stalwarts in the audience, and I'm sure there will be a very vibrant discussion from the entire audience. Just to kick off the discussion, the question that, to tell you the truth, I had in my mind even before I heard your talk, you know, and I cannot get that question off my head. So let me come to that, even though it is not directly about Nehru or imagining Nehru today. The question I have is about the ideological trends, major ideological trends that are there in the politics today. And especially when there is talk of opposition unity to fight effectively against this fascistic regime, you know, then those ideological trends become important. And the curiosity I have, I mean, now that we have got hold of you, you will be among the best persons to answer that, is about this trend that is associated with many names, but let me say with names of Lohia. You know, there are many regional parties at the center of which that Lohia trend is there. You know, now the way it looks, you know, I mean, Lohia's interaction or relationship with Nehru is very well known. Adit Sahab is here, you know, historians would know that better. But we in the politics today, you know, India's politics today, we see that these parties in last 50 years or so, especially after emergency, the role they have played, you know, is a mixed role. Many people who are opposed to the Hindutva majoritarianism, they cannot be absolved from paving the responsibility of paving the way for Hindutva. You know, we on the left are, you know, also part of left is also included. But one ideological segment that I see most responsible is the Indian socialist trend whose name is associated with Lohia. George Fernandes was a key figure. Even Jayaprakash Narayan, if that anti-emergency movement is taken away, how should I remember Jayaprakash Narayan? For what? So whatever politics that was triggered in opposing emergency, which must have been opposed, I should not be mistaken. But the kind of politics that flowed out of there, the road led to Modi. The road led to hegemony of Hindutva. So the relationship of this socialistic trend, you know, the Lohia kind of trend, it seems to be was very problematic with what we are talking today, Nehru's clear-sighted, very visionary, and very worried look at future of India. He knew what India was, you know, I mean, of course, they were great leaders and they lived through partition. You know? So the kind of society, the kind of tectonic plates inside our society we had you know, they were very aware. And that is the relevance of Nehru, as you have so beautifully pointed out. But this problematic role of some of the ideological trends is very relevant even for, let us say, opposition unity today. Or, you know, I mean, when opposition unity gets talked about, people start talking about seats sharing. Everybody wants Congress. Nobody can fight effectively without Congress, but everybody wants Congress to be strong elsewhere, not in their own areas. You know. So how do you see this connection between Nehru and Lohia and the trend that Lohia represented? Because I see it as a very problematic thing that they opened the gateway to today's emergence of or hegemony of Hindutva. So I would like your comment on that. And then I'm sure there will be many questions, and we have such stalwarts in the audience. I'm sure we would be very fortunate to have comments from them too.
Can I just take 1 minute? Because you know, Raviji, aapke sawal ka main jawab kya doon? Because we have the same things in our mind. Even I have these questions in my mind. The other day, my daughter, as I said, she's actually working on the idea of Aditya ji and all know on how JP's anti-emergency movement legitimized Jansang and in a way RSS, in a way. Why? So that's, but on Lohia, I always believe that Lohia should be seen in two phases. One, the Lohia, which was darling of Jawaharlal ji, pre-independence and even some years after independence. I mean, that entire foreign policy thing, what I was referring to, and even the document on fascism, I think it was a combined work of Lohia ji and his team and Jawaharlal ji, because many others were not on board. They were not even aware what is happening in Europe. I think that's one thing. But subsequently, after the CSP got away, then Socialist Party was formed. It was also a war of, I would say, survival for Lohia, for a political space. And many times what happens, I'll tell you, Raviji, there is a phrase that proximity also breeds contempt many a time. So they were very, very proximate to each other. And then that contempt went ahead in terms of electoral battle. But at the same time, I agree with you that Lohiaite movement, particularly JP Lohia, if you look at, there are, data or evidence available, they got legitimacy. And I think the journey that started with them, they have become too powerful now. Probably JP, in one interview I saw, JP thought it would remain a fringe. He never realized. He thought this fringe could be managed, but he never realized that the fringe could be the mainstream one day. And we are all talking that what happened in the past in 75, 77. And one more important thing, which I had addressed that in a different way in my presentation before you. I said regime change won't help. There I actually wanted to emphasize on ideological clarity. Many a time these opposition unity meetings don't look at that, or they think that this could be done. I believe some sort of ideological clarity is a must before you start sitting down for opposition meetings, even before, charting out your common minimum program or the doables. I think somewhere people have started believing that we can have politics in ideological vacuum. There is no such space. That's actually takes us to a regressive journey. But I cannot answer your question because these are my questions also. So let's see the answer in the collective or how they unfold. Thank you.
Before I take up questions, Kumar sir, please, your comment. And... You are mute, Kumar sir. Up mute, okay. please.
Well, Manoj, thank you very much for very eloquent lecture. I can say even defense of Nehru in anti-Nehruvian days. But I want to raise some points. I'm not asking any question, nor am I going to give you a counter speech or something. But I have a feeling that anti-Congressism is actually a misnomer for anti-Nehruism. And anti-Nehruism is being practiced. That's why any congressman who wants to join BJP or any other party is always very welcome. But nobody can welcome the idea of Nehru coming from Nehruvian thinkers, Nehruvian writers, Nehruvian parties. And therefore, anti-Nehruism is the hallmark of anti-Congressism. And Dohia has to be considered, and JP has to be considered from that point of view. That is point number one. Point number two, while we definitely agree that majoritarianism promoted by BJP and RSS and how Nehru had already apprehended that this is a possibility, but why don't we also consider that the left, not only Rohia left, not only socialist left, but the left in general also has betrayed Jawaharlal Nehru, and the culmination is Narendra Modi. Narendra Modi is a product not only of the BJP or of the Jansang and the RSS. Narendra Modi is a product of anti-Congressism. In anti-Congressism, it is not only George Fernandez, or for that matter, Madhuli May, or for that matter, entire JP movement, but Narendra Modi, and therefore, you may remember that Narendra Modi, in his very first speeches, invariably complimented hugely Lohia and Jayaprakash Narayan. So he does not recognize any other political force. He does not recognize the left otherwise. Nehru was also condemned, according to me, wrongly and immaturely by the communist left when he was accused of being running dog of capitalism and was trying to compromise with the colonial rulers. That was the criticism. When Nehru supported the idea of commonwealth, he was condemned as compromising with the imperialism. When Nehru was supporting mixed economy, he was considered as pro-capitalist. When Nehru said that land should not be nationalized, maybe in Soviet Union it was nationalized under Stalin, but we are not going to nationalize land, immediately was seen by some of the left as, you know, actually succumbing to the pressures of the landlords or whoever they were. So point is, actually the left has also paved a way for the kind of anti-Nehruism in the name of anti-Congressism and has allowed Modi to come. And the last point is that intellectuals and the intelligentsia has also betrayed Nehru. You gave a very good example of the Science Congress, but the scientist sitting in front of him and a surgeon sitting in front of him accepted that Ganesh was a surgeon. And so many absurd, nonsense, idiotic ideas that Narendra Modi presented to scientific community, have you seen a single scientist? Have you seen a single intellectual? Have you seen a single person working in all those scientific laboratories questioning Modi? Hey, what are you saying? This is utter nonsense. Nobody has. Not in the media, not in parliament, not even in the scientific conferences. So not only Lohia and JP, but the intellectuals and intelligentsia, the scholarship area, the academic area, as well as the communist left, all of them have betrayed Nehru or Nehruvian idea of India, because they also had relatively narrow focus of what India or idea of India is. And Nehru had a larger and perhaps grander and truly democratic, secular, sovereign nationalist idea, which I don't think anybody in the left also understood adequately. And that's why we are all responsible for the anti-Nehruism, which is masquerading as anti-Congressism.
Ketkar, sir, again, the problem is that when we speak to each other, most of us have a similar kind of mindset. So I agree with you on socialist, I said, but one communist, I like him a lot. I read him a lot. Hiren Mukherjee wrote a biography of Nehru, The Gentle Colossus. And his perspective on Nehru is fundamentally different from the other leftists on the left parties. And I think he has treated Nehru with the kind of brush Nehru deserved.
Comrade Dange and Hiren Mukherjee and such other left have done justice to Nehru, but what I'm saying is the trend.
I agree with you.
That way Mohit Sen was completely pro-Nehru.
Yes, Dange yes.
Was, Hiren Mukherjee was, and there's so many I can say. True. But overall, the tendency of the left was to condemn Nehru. Mm. Along, sometimes even have parliamentary adjustment in parliament with right-wing forces to condemn Nehru or later on the policies. Sorry.
True. That's a fact.
Before I invite others, Professor Aditya Mukherjee, please, your comments would be really good if you have. You're mute, sir. Up mute. Hai. Awaaz nahi aa rahi. Haan, please.
Aditi ji.
Haan. Aditi, please.
Yeah, you were not letting me unmute till now. Sorry about that.
sorry.
Firstly, Manojji, I've been an admirer of you for a long period of time. We share a common view. You practice it at the grassroots in a manner that we would hope many more did. I must say that I enjoyed listening to you, and I'm nobody to comment on what you were saying. But a few suggestions, you know.
Yeah.
We probably agree. One, I would say that it is no longer right to talk of Nehru without Gandhi. One must understand that Nehru's evolution, and you talked about his evolution of everybody, Nehru's evolution also occurs via Gandhi.
Mm-hmm.
You contrast autobiography written in the 1930s, which was in the paradigm of what Professor Bipin Chandra called Stalin Marxism, an orthodox kind of Marxism, to the discovery of India, a far more nuanced, very left, but not within that paradigm, but within the Gramscian paradigm. Since you mentioned Gramsci, Nehru and Gramsci make the breakthrough at the same time. You know, looking at the necessity of democracy within socialism, Nehru said by the late 1930s, there is no democracy without socialism. Socialism cannot be the dictatorship of the proletariat. It must be the dictatorship of 90% of the people, and so on and so forth. I mean, he's anticipating Eurocommunism. He's saying the same thing as Gramsci. I don't know whether they read each other or not, but probably did. Because when I read his autobiography, his discovery, which I was rereading yet again, which you are quite right, is worth rereading several times. I discovered that he is writing in the 1940s from prison with the latest writings on historical material anywhere in the world. He is citing God and Child, what happened in history, etc. And that manuscript is, by the way, kept in the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. And you would be amazed that it is handwritten and probably with hardly any correction. So obviously the man was a genius. But to say the point, to come back to this point, this shift in Nehru's understanding definitely draws from Gandhi. And it is not an accident that Gandhiji, as early as 1942, said that it is not Vallabhbhai, it is not Rajaji, but it will be Jawahar who will be my successor. When I'm gone, Gandhiji said, he will speak
my language. My language.
He'll speak my language. And he was absolutely right in that. When we meet, I would love to discuss more on this aspect with you, that how he borrows from Gandhiji, particularly the notion of nonviolence, the notion of difference, of a dialogical tradition, working with the opposition, not having a notion of absolute truth. The reason why Gandhiji goes for nonviolence is not because it was a smart strategy against the British, which it was. He does it because philosophically, he says that if you are a person in quest of truth and not somebody who believes in having transcendental or absolute truth in your hands, then you cannot be violent towards the other. In other words, Nehru and Gandhi, and this has now been written, I will share with you the work on these, both of them were appropriating the Enlightenment values and implementing it better than the Enlightenment itself. Because the Enlightenment led to the French Revolution, Russian Revolution, Chinese Revolution, which led to the killing of mass killings of people in the name of democracy. So it was inherently contradictory. It was the Indian experiment with the Enlightenment, and in which Nehru draws from ancient India to Akbar, right through Akbar to the present. He draws from Indian civilizational history. That is something to be remembered. And I would say that Nehru, you're right, is best seen in praxis. Probably even more, Gandhiji is best seen in praxis. But Nehru is also a philosopher. I mean, when I reread Discovery of India, I mean, it is, there is the recent book which is written by Manoj Acharya. That he draws out this philosophical aspect that is there in Nehru. So that is one thing. What Raviji has said is absolutely, of course, our shared problem, legitimacy given by the opposition. And the emergency is no argument, because this legitimacy was given before the emergency was launched, the joining hands with the RSS. In the 60s, there was no emergency. In 1989, there was no emergency. In the India Against Corruption, there was no emergency.
No emergency.
But in all these, people joined hands with communal forces because they happened to be popular at that time. And this is again where I totally agree with you, that let us learn from Gandhi and Nehru that we do not, if something is already a popular idea, one doesn't have to give in to it. After all, it is in the 1940s, 47, 46 to 48, the toughest period in Indian history, when the Indian people are communalized to the extreme. We are in a Holocaust-like situation. That Gandhi and Nehru, without fear, speak, in favor of Muslims. Gandhiji goes on a fast saying they're not afraid of saying the Muslim word, as everybody is these days. So they were able to say what was to be said, even if it meant standing against the current. This was the second thing I would like to say. The third, where I may have a bit of a difference, is not the platform to discuss it, but I'll just flag it, that to say that the economic reforms in 1991 was a total rejection of Nehru is something that I would not agree with, because the nature of world capitalism had changed in the late 1990s. It is not an accident that from Sukhumai Chakravarti to Amartya Sen to Arjun Sengupta, all communists, to Deng, to Cardozo, to Lula, that everybody accepted economic reforms and globalization because something had changed. So, and I would argue that in the 1990s, Nehru would have also done something like what Manmohan Singh did. Just as Manmohan Singh would have been stupid if he tried to do liberalization in the 1950s, because then it would have made India into a banana republic if he tried to do that then. In the 1990s, it did not make sense because of a number of reasons, which we can discuss at another time. Certainly, this was best articulated by Cardozo, the first Brazilian minister who brought Brazil into democracy and into globalization. And when he visited India in the late 1990s, he met a large number of intellectuals, mainly communists, and they accused him and they said, exactly, almost similar to the way you did just now accuse Nehru, the left now. He said that, Professor Cardozo, you are a Marxist, you are a left dependency thinker. How could you lead Brazil into globalization and economic reform? So Cardozo gave a reply which you might find very interesting, which I've quoted in our book. He said that, look, you're asking me the wrong question. If you ask the question whether to globalize or not, it's a wrong question. In the post bamboo curtain, post iron curtain era, that is in the 1990s, he said, if you do not globalize, you'll become a Myanmar. The question that you can ask as a progressive is, how do I globalize? Not whether I globalize or not. How do I globalize? Do I globalize with my sovereignty intact, number one? Or do I disappear in the United States armpit? The question number two, do I globalize and do structural reforms with a safety net for the poor? Or do I do it in the Latin American manner where we do not do it? And Cardozo said that in India, you are better off than in Brazil because you have the Gandhi-Nehru tradition. Your people will not allow that economic reform and globalization to go in the direction of abandoning sovereignty or giving up the poor. And you see the history of the 1990s, all the right-based legislation come simultaneously with the economic crisis. It is our democracy which ensures that at least at that time we did not sell our sovereignty or our poor. What you're saying is true of now, you know, not of 1990s. What is happening in today's kind of economic and globalization is total abandonment of both our sovereignty and our poor. But on the whole, we are totally agree on that. And last comment, if you will permit.
Sure, sir. Pleasure. I'm noting down everything.
We must also learn from, you know, jab kehte hain na ki majboori ka naam Mahatma Gandhi hai, to humko majboori ka naam Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. In a situation where we are faced with a fascist situation. We need to learn from both of them of how to carry everyone together, including your opponents. Look at Nehru's first cabinet. Look at Gandhi's insistence on bringing Ambedkar as the chairman of the drafting committee. Ambedkar didn't have to be elected on a Congress ticket. He lost on his own. So they were brought in because you wanted the national interest. You had a question of nation building. Today we are in the same situation. Our nation is in threat. If we are now to quibble over left, right, semi-left, socialist, communist, toh mare gaye. You know, as Raviji correctly said, now is the time to draw from these people and bring every conceivable political formation together to remove this evil that has set on our society. But thank you very much for your talk and your great performance in parliament and in public life. Thank you.
Thank you, Mukherjee sir. I have noted down everything and I tell you, ग्रेजुएशन जब कर रहा था उसके बाद से पढ़ना आप लोगों को शुरू किया तो व्हाटएवर आइडियाज आए हैं आई थिंक यू ऑल हैव बीन ग्रेट कंट्रीब्यूटर टू दैट मिलना बहुत बाद में हुआ और आज भी जो आपने कही गांधी वाली बात आई 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 अश्योर यू आई विल रीवर्क ऑन सम ऑफ द प्रेमिसेस आई हैव यूज्ड एंड यस माय आइडिया ऑफ रेफरेंस टू 1990 वाज व्हाट यू योरसेल्फ सेड यू कुड हैव सेड दिस I just looked at the journey of liberalization and that's why they came. That's one of the hazards in a 15-minute, 45-minute thing. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Niranjan Pant has raised his hand. I request him to unmute and share his views or comments, please, or questions. Niranjan, sir, please.
Yes. Firstly, let me compliment Professor Jha, belonging as he does to post-Nehru generation to so imaginatively imagine Nehru.
And to sir, can't him. See you. I can't see you. I want to see you.
Okay.
Yes.
So I must compliment you that as someone who belongs to a post-Nehru generation to remember so imaginatively Nehru. And it's very gratifying to know this. I also want to say that I think that Nehru was a colossal, but in any discourse which reimagines Nehru, we must also visit the dark corners. We also, otherwise it would become a kind of hagiographical account of someone who is far too big for us to come out of his shadow. So I would play a little devil's advocate and put out a few points for your consideration. I think one of the cardinal problems, and I know that it is very easy to go back in past and post-judge people with all that, but, and I also preface these points by my saying that I am a great admirer of Nehru. I think that he was a colossal, but when we are reimagining him, we cannot but have to revisit their dark spots. Some simplistic point, I'm not an academic like you and other people in the gathering. I think one of the cardinal problems was that he tolerated, if not promoted, right-wingers and closet fascists, both in INC and in the government. The second cardinal problem was that he sidelined socialists and other intellectuals who could give him intellectual competition, like JP, Narendev, Lohia, and all, which formed the Congress Socialist Party. Particularly Lohia and JP, I think it was a cardinal mistake of Nehru to have sidelined him and sidelined them and virtually silenced them into political oblivion. I also think that image of Nehru got better of him in Nehru's own mind, and he clung to the top till the death and illness claimed him. In my view, the depreciation of Nehru started when he decided to move to the Flagstaff House and to shun his Nehru jacket for the buttonhole Sherwani. He removed himself. He promoted a kind of political elitism, which has led us to the situation where we are today. I also think that one of the major mishaps of Nehruvian times was not enough attention to basic and primary education, if not health also, which is responsible for such a mass of illiterate people in this country, illiterate not in the sense of school education, but illiterate in their minds, that we are tolerating the present situation which we all bemoan. I think he inadvertently promoted political elitism, which combined with pseudo-liberalism and corruption has led first to the vile phenomena of his daughter Indira Gandhi, and now to the fascist takeover. So these are the points we must remember in our discourse, and we must mention it.
Why do you call it, these are the dark sides of, these are not. You have helped me by putting these questions. It's a kind of emotional turmoil in last 1 or 2 minutes. For instance, Lohia and JP, I would not want, all these issues, I agree with you 100% that we must look at it, but we must also remember those years, a huge nation, partition, our economic balance sheet was not very rosy, yet he could have done much better than, on those parameters, what you said. But about JP, as far as I know, through JP's own memoir, JP's own letters, JP had a very different kind of relationship with Jawaharlal Ji. And many people thought JP to be the successor of Jawaharlal Ji. Jawaharlal Ji explored the possibility of him joining the cabinet or joining the government. I'll just tell you one interesting issue which I raised in the parliament also. He was very passionate about Kashmir, JP. He wrote 2 letters, one to Jawaharlal Ji and one to Indira Ji in subsequent years. If I write those letters today to my PM, I'll be behind the bar under sedition law. Why I'm saying this, if you read the content of that letter, he was actually telling Nehru that you cannot hold Kashmir on the basis of the gun. Nobody can say. That's why I believe these are the pointers which you have shared and raised. Certainly, I'll take into account, sir. I promise you, because Aditi ji.
I would just say that JP had a sterling integrity, not only in his political discourse, which very few could have matched.
Yes.
And I am very unhappy that person of his quality was sidelined. I don't know whether you have had occasion. I have read a series of essays published by him in, of all things, in a magazine which used to be published earlier called Bhavan's Journal. My uncle used to have some old issues, and there was a series of lovely articles, and I don't find them in any anthology. And in that, there were the articles written by political statesmen of the kind of which we haven't seen. And where he is very, very strongly pleading for decentralization, the real decentralization. Again, another thing which Nehru can be accused of is promoting inadvertently centralization of polity. But JP was also kind of on Nagaland. He had a stand which very few of us can take.
Yes, that was a different kind of league. And the problem with us today is when we sit down in 2023 and we talk about it, there shall be gaps in our understanding. There shall be when we reimagine. So I said my reimagination would lack some of the basic points which should have figured. But then, like it is said, that all dreams are not similar. Everybody dreams a different way. So in that context, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Manoj sir, there is this question in the chat box of what similarities and difference you see. It's a question by Dr. Pramod Joshi. What similarities and differences you see between Pandit Nehru and Pandit Narendra Modi as parliamentarians? A question.
Let me talk about differences first. Differences, as I have understood through different recordings and writings, Jawaharlal ji used to spend a lot of time in, I'll tell you, in the parliament, when the parliament was in session. The trend started declining immediately after Jawaharlal ji, but now, the present prime minister, when he comes to parliament, it's almost like a discovery for many that the PM has come, that the PM has come. Now, this is one difference. Second, Nehru was very comfortable with criticism. I mean, if he didn't get criticism, he used to write criticism of himself. And there are parliamentary records where people made all kinds of attack, and he didn't take it personally. He never counted the kind of abuses. Ki 91 ho gaye, 92 ho gaye, 93 ho gaye. He never counted that. So, I mean, there are a number of differences. Differences I can keep talking. His approach towards his own cabinet, his priorities, the way he addressed his people, the people of India, there was a kind of camaraderie. There was no client-patron relationship. He would never consider his people as labharthis. So I think that this is what, now when it comes to similarity, the only similarity I find is in the Nehru jacket, which he calls the Modi jacket, and nothing else, practically nothing.
Thank you. Shukla Sen has raised some questions in the chat box. I will request him to unmute himself and raise the comment and questions himself. Shukla Sen, sir. Are you here? Are you able to hear me, Shukla Sen, sir? Oh, he's not here.
Or he has... Chat box mein hai kya?
Yeah, chat box mein hai. Chat box mein ke sawal hai. So I will read it out for you then. If you can see,
yeah,
can
on the understanding, no.
Yeah. It is, now I have been able to unmute myself.
Yeah, please.
Yes,
please.
Sir.
So I'll not get into all this. Actually, sir, I'll only.
Shukla Sen sir, I want to see you also. Switch on your.
Sorry, actually, my connection is weak, so I don't normally. Anyways, the point is, Nehru, when he became the prime minister, he essentially represented the tradition of Indian national liberation movement and carried that tradition to post-independent India. And the future that he had envisaged was essentially a welfare, capitalist state. Nehru has written Discovery of India. To my mind, Discovery of India is actually invention of India. There is no India, Indian state in any case before the British state. Indian national movement based taking up from the state created by the British, the stood up an Indian nation. And Nehru and others were quite aware of it, while all at the same time they were claiming that India was their state economy. Fine. So Nehru was already in favor of centralization. Nehru was never in favor of decentralization. So asking Nehru to decentralize is simply pointless. It was not in his idea. He was a democrat, but he was not a decentralizer. And he was also a capital student. There is no, but within the welfare framework. So that's the point. The second point I would like to raise, that when you are discussing it today, I felt a bit disappointed if you didn't try to chart out a roadmap, what is to be done now. India, quote-unquote India, that was created by the Indian National Movement is now being systematically dismantled. Nothing less than that. It's a very serious situation, and it also poses an existential threat in a very literal sense to so many. So under the circumstances, what do we do? That's all. Thanks.
Thank you, Senator. फ्रेंड्स एक तो क्लैरिटी नहीं थी, लेकिन फिर भी जो मैं समझ पाया उस हिसाब से मैं समझता हूं कि एक चीज जो उन्होंने सेंट्रलाइजेशन को लेके कही उस पर मैं पहले नहीं सोचा था, आदित्य जी वगैरह बताएंगे. इफ यू लुक एट द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ पार्टीशन एंड द इंडिपेंडेंस, आई थिंक डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन एंड एज एन आइडिया सर्टनली वॉज नॉट a very lucrative idea, doable idea at that point of time. Every idea has a kind of fertile period, acceptance period. I think that was the time when we had just come about violent massacres in different parts of this country. I don't know how decentralization. I think I leave that to other panelists if they wish to. And when I reimagined, Senza asked me, what should be the roadmap? Reimagination was actually the roadmap, that what we could do, what we should do, what we must do. Now, doing is not only about the political parties. It's all also about civil society. What are we doing? In my classroom, am I getting that message conveyed? In my media, am I getting the message conveyed? In my home, I think this is one space where I'm able to convey these messages. I think all of us, as the German philosopher said, that we need to be actually proficient in the art of selling an idea everywhere, beginning from home. I think that's what I would like to sum up. Thank you, sir.
We are with us, Professor Mrudula Mukherjee.
I will request
her to please unmute herself and please.
No, please do. And Mrudula ji and Nehru. And ye to wo main begani shaadi mein Abdullah type ho raha
hu. Nahi, please. Nahi. Share her views. Mrudula ji, please. Professor Mrudula Mukherjee, please. Unmute kar pa rahi hai aapko apne aap ko?
Yeah, I'm not going to put on the video because my connection is not very good.
Please,
but,
please.
So I'll just say a few words. I want to congratulate Manoj ji for.
Manoj, you call me Manoj, not Manoj.
Okay. Yeah, the G was a little forced. But given the audience, I thought respect is due. Nevertheless, yes, Manoj. I was in fact remembering many years back when I came, you had organized a wonderful seminar on Jawaharlal Nehru. in
that the, was 2014, and that happened to be 125th birth year of Jawaharlal ji.
Absolutely, and it was a very, very good seminar that you had organized at the Delhi School of Social Work. So I was recalling that today when I was, reminding myself to be there for your talk. I just wanted to say a few things. One is, I think in a way a right comment that it should not become hagiography. But on the other hand, I do wish to say that, now when we talk about Nehru or when we talk about Gandhi or when we talk about, the heroes of the freedom struggle, Bhagat Singh, Subhash Bose, whatever. See, we are not here only as historians doing a critical overall assessment. What begins to sound like hagiography is not intended as such, but the point is we are trying to see what can we gain from them today to handle our problems. So often we are highlighting, and I think rightly so, those aspects of their contribution, their work, their lives, which are extremely relevant to us today. So if we, for example, as you did, focus on Nehru's steadfast, unambiguous stand on the issue of communalism and secularism, especially, of course, there Gandhiji is also extremely important, as Aditya pointed out, the period 46 to 48. In Nehru's case, it is even more important to point out that he was the first person in the 1930s who evolved a sophisticated critique of communalism in the Indian context. He was the first to do so, and it was a theoretical critique. Therefore, he had a, I would say, a very theoretical mind. Only unlike others from the left, he deliberately, or for whatever reason, did not write within a strict theoretical mode of presentation, but he understood complex theoretical issues as well as any hardcore Marxist did. But his whole style of writing and his whole approach was to make his ideas and to present the problems in a manner that people could understand. Because he was not just a theoretician, he was a leader, a communicator, a mass leader. Let's not forget that after Gandhiji, and when Gandhiji, in a sense, stopped doing the grassroots level mobilization of touring the country incessantly, etc., from the 1930s, it is Nehru who did that job. He was the only All India mass leader. Patel was a mass leader very much in Gujarat. He's the Sardar of Bardoli. He's the leader of the flag Satyagraha. He's a big mass leader, but not all over India. If all over India, after Gandhiji, there was any mass leader, and we tend to forget this, it was only Jawaharlal Nehru. The 1936-37 elections, the touring, the campaigning is done almost solely by Nehru at an All India level. Going from place to place, village to village, province by province. So I think it's important to remember those aspects of his touch with the common people. We have somewhere started imbibing this whole attack on him of being elitist, of being Brahminical, of being Western. Here was a man who was who started his political career in the villages of India.
Yes.
The Kisan movement in 1920-21, please read the autobiography. Please read other writings, his writings in the newspapers at that time, where he used to live among the Kisans for days on end. In the heat of May, June, he's walking for miles and miles among the Kisans of Awadh. So he is also a mass peasant leader, just as Sardar Patel was. Just as Gandhiji went to Champaran, so we have also an image of Nehru, a sanitized, westernized, we've sort of swallowed many of the stuff in our public discourse. Just as you rightly countered the notion that his secularism was some Western concept. No. You know, his secularism was also a very Indian secularism, but the essence of his secularism was the same as that of Gandhiji. Only the presentations were different. The mode of expression was different. Gandhiji was no less secular than Jawaharlal Nehru. If the essence of secularism is, are you willing to even put your life on stake for the basic principle of secularism, as Gandhiji was, and he did, you know? So here, there are different articulations, I think, and that was the beauty of the freedom struggle, that it had leaders within it who were able to articulate the broad spectrum of ideas in different ways so that it appreciated and approached, it made sense to different people, because the national movement had to attract different people. It had to attract the intellectual, the poet, the thinker, the peasant, the worker, the artisan, the woman, the unlettered. So this precisely, the modes of articulation should not confuse us about, you know, the essence of the ideas being a broad spectrum of very modern ideas of secularism. You may call it, give it some terminology here or there, but they were very modern ideas of secularism. The essence of secularism was, don't, you can call it Western or Indian, but they linked it up, and Nehru did also link it up with Indian tradition constantly. The essence of Indian tradition, he went on telling us, was harmony, was living together, was respecting different religions, you know. So I would also just like to say just a little bit, I'm sorry, but on the JP issue, I think Manoj has already countered that, but from what little I have read from Nehru's writings, his letters, his entreaties to Jayaprakash Narayan to stay on in the Congress, I think if I would object to the use of the word that he marginalized the socialists, that he marginalized because somewhere he was, you know, I mean, we forget today he was such a colossus. Yes, JP had, you can, whether he had total integrity and Nehru had less than total, I don't want to get into that argument. After what happened during the struggle against the emergency, where he compromised with the most regressive of political forces. I don't know what integrity means. We are not talking of personal integrity there. I don't think it's an argument of one against the other. But politically speaking, to say that it was Nehru who marginalized the socialists, I think is factually wrong. He was always trying to persuade them to stay within the Congress. It was they who decided to leave at every step. And in fact, that was Nehru's tragedy, that the forces who were ideologically his allies left him organizationally, ideologically in the 50s. So to say he compromised with people who were semi-fascist, this thing, he had to run a government. What was he supposed to do? Also leave the Congress and join the KMT or whatever, you know, version of socialist. They split into so many parties. What was Nehru supposed to do? Also abandon the boat. I'm sorry, I'm being a little, sharp on this, but it is a fact that, you know, I don't think Nehru was the kind of person who could not work with other people. On the contrary, if he could make compromises with people who were not ideologically on his side, surely he was more than willing to make compromises with people who were ideologically his allies. Let us remember that even later, Indira Gandhi and Jayaprakash Narayan remained very close at a personal level. Even till the end, the negotiations were going on, and at a very intimate personal level. So, you know, those are also all facts of history. So in an to just to say that it should not become hagiography does not also mean that we accept the critical comments or the critical framework which others have adopted to Nehru as the truth. Objectivity doesn't mean pros and cons. Objectivity means getting to the truth. And here the truth may be tilted more in favor of Nehru than in favor of you know, many of the others whom we are espousing. I think I'll stop there. I've already taken a lot of your time.
Thank you, Mridula. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mridula.
You're welcome.
There is a question. Yeah, please.
Go ahead.
Professor Rajiv Mandal has raised a question in the chat box, but he's here, but I request him to unmute and share his question. Professor Rajiv Mandal from Banaras Hindu University, our old friend.
Subhash, yes. you have to click ask to unmute on, when you ask people to unmute, you have to click on ask to unmute button, Subhash. Oh. Then they will be able
I'm
to
doing
unmute.
That.
Oh. Yeah, please do it.
Am I audible now?
Rajiv, please go ahead.
Okay. I have raised it on this forum again and again that JP was great. Yes, we agree. But he has really spread a red carpet welcome during JP movement to the fascist forces. That is the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. It was a legitimacy. So some comment, and only gentleman that I'm aware of, maybe others must have written, Dange, I remember. He was saying that this is the principal contradiction. I'm invoking principal contradiction. Okay, recently it has been done by the Chinese president. I think Manoj may not like it because being Lohiite. So what I'm trying to understand is that giving red carpet welcome and looking at the intellectual height of Jayaprakash ji, it's difficult. It's difficult to comprehend why did he do this? And the Dange was being by all my ultra left friends that revisionist ho gaya, ye ho gaya, wo ho gaya. I can go on. I'm basically not a student of social science, but I thought it appropriate. And thanks. I'm on the same boat thanks to 201 for that. I was forced to go through Glimpses of the World History and others. Just as a student, I used to go. Thank you very much for giving me the support.
Rajivji, this is one area where I'm in sync with you about, as I said also in one of the response to one question. That entire anti-emergency movement and JP's position and JP justified, they got legitimacy. And from there, we actually lost the grip over this trajectory. So I don't find I have any reason to disagree with you.
Ravi, you were saying something.
Ravi ji.
I think part of what I was, I was just... snatching a second opportunity to come in. Part of it is said by Professor Mandal, but since Manoj is here, Adit Sahab, Mridula ji, all these people are here, I cannot stop myself from asking that, can you put your finger on the political ideological makeup of a leader or a person that makes it impossible for him to go to Sangh Parivar, or that makes him easy to go to the Sangh Parivar? I can imagine that Nehru could never have gone over to Sangh Parivar. And as his great grandson, you know, many people become offended by these family connections, and many people think that the family controls Congress. I doubt that. You know, I mean, Congress cannot keep itself together without the family. Then what can the family do? But Rahul, I cannot imagine, can walk over to Sangh Parivar. But many others, you know, I mean, have hobnobbed with Sangh Parivar. Many great names that we are being mentioned in this discussion have hobnobbed with Sangh Parivar or have not been careful enough to about them. So can you put your finger, what makes a person go over or not be allergic to Sangh Parivar? You know, what was the characteristic, what was in Nehru or what is in Rahul that they can never, you know, be go over to Sangh Parivar?
I can only refer it to some great psychoanalytical people, those who do psychoanalytics. The one book which I remembered, it was probably by Reck, The Mass Psychology of Fascism. Something, I think I leave this to Mridula ma'am or Aditi ji, or even for a future reference point, but the question is very interesting. What is there? I mean, examining the personality trait. I remember, aap sabko pata hoga, phir bhi main bataun. Amartya Sen, in his book, that the book on violence, he refers to one case of Italy, where he says that an Italian fascist goes to a countryside. Aur wo wahan poochte hain, kehte hain ki bhai tum फैसिस्ट पार्टी ज्वाइन करो तो वो बंदा जो गांव में है वो कह रहा है कि मैं कैसे ज्वाइन कर सकता हूं मेरे फादर कम्युनिस्ट थे और वो सोशलिस्ट थे तो ये फैसिस्ट कहता है जो प्रोपेगेंडा वाला था कि अरे अगर तुम्हारे फादर डकैत होते तुम्हारे ग्रैंडफादर मतलब हत्यारे होते तो क्या तुम भी वही होते बोला नहीं तब मैं फैसिस्ट पार्टी में आ जाता
A chat box mein question, there is one question by Mr. Harikishan Patel. Professor Jha, how can the scientific mind of the Indian people be instilled as this was the main task of Nehru?
But Subhash, please take that question, but I would also, if Adit Sahab or Mithila Ji or Ketkar Sahab would like
to comment on. Please.
Yeah. सुभाष जी ये क्वेश्चन ये जो है ना कि साइंटिफिक टेम्पर ये उसी तरह की चीज है कि सेक्युलरिज्म को कैसे सेफगार्ड किया जाए डेमोक्रेसी को कैसे सेफगार्ड किया जाए आई विश वी हैड अ मैकेनिज्म जैसे कोविड की वैक्सीन आई अगर ऐसा कोई वैक्सीन होता तो इसके बारे में कहा जाता कि बच्चे को पोलियो के टीके के साथ ये वैक्सीन भी डाल दो तो फिर एक्चुअली इट इज एक्चुअली कलेक्टिव हमने अपनी डेमोक्रेसी को ना बहुत इंडिविजुअल सेंटर्ड बना दिया And when you make anything individual centered, तो अक्सर आप देखोगे ना opposition unity में भी तुम्हारा चेहरा कौन है? They will not ask you about program. They will not ask you about everyday life issues. Now this is where I think all of us have a role to play. Bring democracy back to basics. क्योंकि individual centered हो जाने से ना वो थोड़ा सा megalomaniac वाला वो tendency इंसान को लगता है कि मैं और देश एक जैसे हैं। आप देख लो सेडिशन के जितने केस चल रहे हैं 90% क्रिटिक ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट इज परसीव्ड टू बी क्रिटिक ऑफ द नेशन तो मैं समझता हूं कि वो सब के लिए और साइंटिफिक टेंपर भी एक्चुअली समवेयर वी हैव टू मेक अ डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन फेथ एंड सुपरस्टिशन मतलब फेथ है मेरा लेकिन सुपरस्टिशन नहीं है वो नहीं होना और अभी क्या हो रहा है ना सुपरस्टिशन इज बीइंग प्रमोटेड In the name of faith. And that's worrisome. Ek agrah karun, Bhattacharya sahab, 8-5 mein humko, thodi der ke, matlab maa ko ek dawa deni hoti hai, to can we wind up, agar aapki permission ho, nahi to main aage karta.
Theek,
ye sawal Ravi ji keh rahe the, Mridula ma'am se, wo jo inka sawal tha, ki wo kya hoti hai,
I don't have the answer to Raviji's question in the psychological sense, but the only thing that makes sense to me is that why did Nehru have this ideological clarity? And what is needed to have a what shall I say, an unambiguous position on the issue of communism? What prevents you from having a tendency to join the Sangh Parivar? I think in terms of ideology, I think Nehru's formulation that communalism or if fascism ever comes to India, it will come in the form of majority communalism. To me, that is one of the most important elements in Nehru's understanding of communalism and fascism and understanding how it will play out in the Indian case. that here it will be a Hindu supremacist ideology that will provide the foundation to fascism, and we are seeing that. This understanding that communalism is essentially anti-democratic, that of course minority communalism also is a big issue, but majority communalism is a bigger danger because it can then take the form of fascism. So I think this, to me as a historian, when I look back, I think this element, and I can tell you in my own understanding that while over the years studying the issue of communalism in India, as many of us who didn't start off with that being our major concern, but as the problem enveloped our society, we moved more and more towards studying that phenomenon. To me, that still is, in a sense, the anchor to which one has to hold on to. You know, because other things you can still say, oh, this is a cultural revival, this is a that. You know, this is only expressing certain historical sense of historical wrongs or whatever, you know, oppression and whatnot. But I think if it comes to the point where you realize that to save your constitution, to save the heritage of your freedom struggle, the essence of which is democracy, you cannot give counter, you cannot give any space to the Hindu supremacist ideology, because that's where it's going to end up. That's where it's going to take. That's the essence of their ideology. And this is what has led then many of us to go back to and try to study and analyze from the writings of the original founders of this ideology, the essence. And there we have found it is all there. Nehru understood it. They were his contemporaries. I mean, I'm sure he read and analyzed and saw their politics at first hand. That it's there in Golwalkar, it's there in Hedgewar, it's there in Savarkar, but in plain, simple language. You only have to read to be able to understand. There's not a single democratic idea in their writings or thought. You know, there is no democracy of any kind, just as there was not in the Muslim League. Muslim League had no element of democracy in it. Similarly, the Hindu fascist communal parties also in their thinking had no element of, not even a concession to democracy. This has only come being beaten black and blue by Nehru later. RSS put into jail, marginalized, you know, then they had to struggle to stay afloat and they had to struggle to come back into the electoral arena, and therefore acceptance of electoral democracy. But don't for a moment believe that they have any faith in it at all. It's just not there in their thinking, and it shows up every once in a while, just as they are basically anti-Gandhi. Let's never forget that, and it's coming out every day now. Do you think that a minister speaks, a chief minister speaks, without the top leadership of the RSS and the BJP being aware of it or permitting it or whatever, or encouraging it? It cannot happen, because the nature of the politics is such that there is no such freedom to people to speak their mind. Congress mein to hota rehta hai ki unko pata hi nahi hai ki kaun kya bol raha hai kab, sach mein. Par ye RSS BJP mein aise nahi hota hai. So when it happens, it is part of an organized project. You allow, you encourage people at various levels to float ideas to see how much are people reacting. How far can you go on the anti-Gandhi track? These are all ways of checking out, you know, how much our people will swallow when we go to the extent of glorifying the assassin in broad daylight. And that's what's happening right now. They're testing Indian society. How much can we get away with? How far can we go in 2024?
सबसे पहले तो यह बता दूं, इस निराशाजनक माहौल में राज्यसभा से आपकी आती ही आवाज एक जो है आशा का संचार देती हम लोगों को। दो तीन मेरा सवाल जो है, ये सुभाष जी ने बताया कि सबको जाना है, लेकिन मेरे सवाल दो तीन है। और ये तो वो नेहरू जो है उनके विषय में जो है ये सब जो चर्चा हुई और उनके डेमोक्रेटिक होने पे, उनके विजनरी होने पर जो है बहुत ही मतलब उनका हम आदर से बचपन से ही बहुत आदर से ये सब चीजें देखते हैं। लेकिन ये दो तीन बातें जो हैं मेरे दिमाग में, उस पर जरा चर्चा हो जाए तो आप जैसे विद्वान लोग बताएंगे तो अच्छा रहेगा। ये तो केरल की जो है इलेक्टेड गवर्नमेंट, उनके नेतृत्व में उसको जो है कैसे जो है किया गया। और दूसरा सवाल कश्मीर को लेके जो है इतना वो रिजिड उनके दिमाग में वो बात कैसे थी, और रिफरेंडम वो क्यों नहीं कराया गया। और तीसरा सवाल ये व्यक्तिगत है, अब इसमें कितनी सच्चाई है, जैसे चर्चा होती है कि इंदिरा गांधी जी के उनके जो है मैरिज फेयर फिरोज गांधी से उनका जो है बहुत ज्यादा उसमें विरोध था, या फिर बाद के जो उनके संबंध थे फिरोज गांधी से वो बहुत ही बिटर थे। तो ये इन तीन चीजों पे थोड़ी सी यदि चर्चा हो जाती।
क्या राणा प्रताप जी, जो तीसरा प्रश्न है इंदिरा जी की शादी और उनकी बेरुखी जो अलग अलग तरह की सोर्सेस से आता है, मैं समझता हूँ इसका नेहरूवियन आइडिया से कोई खास ताल्लुक नहीं है। वो उस पर अलग अलग लोगों के संदर्भ में मृदुला जी जवाब देना चाहेंगे। तो और कश्मीर को लेकर के भी जो आपने कहा ना, कश्मीर को लेकर के भी नेहरू जी के संदर्भ में कई भ्रांतियां हैं, उन भ्रांतियों का निराकरण किया जा चुका है। लेकिन क्या होता है ना कि भ्रांतियों का निराकरण हमारे जैसे लोग व्हाट्सएप में नहीं कर पाते हैं। हम आर्टिकल लिख देते हैं, हम वो साक्ष्य रख देते हैं, और चूंकि लोग आजकल वो चाहते हैं कि जल्दी में कुछ समझ में आ जाए। नेहरू अगर जो ट्रीटी ऑफ एक्सेशन था, जो जिसमें जिसके बाद कश्मीर का भारत में विलय हुआ ना, उसको समझने के लिए उसके पीछे जाकर के शेख अब्दुल्ला और नेहरू के रिश्ते को समझना होगा। नेहरू की को अरेस्ट किया गया था उस वक्त के हालात, तो मुझको लगता है ना कि कश्मीर को लेकर के जो एक बीजेपी और संघ परिवार मैस्कुलिन पॉलिसी की बात करती है, जो अभी चलाने की कोशिश भी कर रहे हैं लेकिन हासिल कुछ नहीं हो रहा है, क्योंकि कश्मीर के साथ दिक्कत क्या है ना कि आपको कश्मीरी आवाम और कश्मीर की जमीन के बीच में हाइफन नहीं लगाना है। नेहरू ये हाइफन नहीं लगाते थे, गलतियां हुई, वहां भी सरकारें गई, अरेस्ट हुए शेख अब्दुल्ला, लेकिन ये हाइफन कभी नहीं उनके जहन में था। ये नेहरू की कमिटमेंट थी, चूंकि वो हिस्टोरिकली चीजों को देख रहे थे। आज के दौर के लोगों की तरह नहीं कि बौनी समझ के आधार पर कोई डिसीजन ले लिया और माईवे और हाईवे में चल पड़े। केरला के गवर्नमेंट को अपदस्थ करने की जो डिसमिस करने की बात हो रही है, ये एक ऐसा चैप्टर है जिस पर नेहरू के दौर में भी काफी लिखा गया। कई लोग ये भी मानते हैं कि नेहरू व्यक्तिगत तौर पर इसके पक्ष में नहीं थे। मैं सिर्फ इतना ही कह करके खत्म करूंगा कि किसी के बारे में जब हम चर्चा करेंगे ना, तो करिकुलम वाइटे में कई सारी चीजें होंगी जो जहां पर थोड़ा ऐसा फेज है कि जिस पर और क्लैरिटी की जरूरत है। लेकिन केरल होने के बावजूद भी जो वहां की सरकार अपदस्थ हुई, उसके बावजूद भी डेमोक्रेसी के इंडेक्स में 100 में अगर हम मापेंगे ना, तो नेहरू आपको 90 से ऊपर जाते हैं। कुछ पार्टी का दबाव होता है, कुछ कई दफा पार्टी की महत्वाकांक्षा भी कुछ ऐसी गलतियां करवाती है कि शायद जो पार्टी का सुप्रीम लीडर होता है वो अलाइन ना करे, लेकिन फिर भी करना पड़ता है। इसके अतिरिक्त अभी इस छोटे से फॉर्मेट में और कुछ कहा नहीं जा सकता था। शुक्रिया सर।
केरल के बारे में मैं एक थोड़ा सा कमेंट कर सकता हूँ?
जी सर बिल्कुल,
प्लीज। क्योंकि ये सवाल, ये पुराने सवाल हैं, कश्मीर केरल सुन सुन के मतलब बहुत हजारों बार जवाब देने पड़ते हैं, पर केरल पे ये रिसर्च शोज और ये एस गोपाल जिन्होंने ये थ्री वॉल्यूम बायोग्राफी लिखी, प्रॉब्ली द बेस्ट बायोग्राफर ऑफ नेहरू, उनका भी ये समझना है दैट द डिसमिसल ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट इज इन अ कॉन्टेक्स्ट. द कॉन्टेक्स्ट वाज दैट द कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी टुक पोजीशंस इन केरला व्हिच मेड देम ह्यूजली अनपॉपुलर. दे वर जंपिंग मेनी स्टेजेस और वहां के जो एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं उस पर वो चेंज ला रहे थे. एंड यू नो the various powers that we are, how strong they are in the educational institutions in Kerala. So there was a mass uprising in Kerala, and Nehru actually delivered the Communist Party by dismissing the party. This is also a position that you may put, that it was a favor done to them, and it was not as if he was anti-communist, because you must put it in a context. There is not a whiff of anti-communism in Nehru right through this period. He wants them with him. As Madhula said, that he saw them as his best allies. He says, "Main program lata hu, main legislation karta hu, tum implement karwao." Wo kehte nahi, tum to running dog of imperialism. To tumhare sath hum kaise kaam karenge? It was the other way around. It was not he trying to bring down the communists kicking him away. But in the Kerala case, this is a notion that is worth investigating. People are still looking into it, but that it is credible that this is the reason why he dismissed the government. He was certainly not an anti-democratic person, just like you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Manoj, because of the interesting theme you chose for this discussion, and like your interventions in the parliamentary debate, this also your talk also has provoked many questions and many interesting debate has arisen. So we once again thank you on behalf of NSI. For joining this debate.
एक सेकेंड लू
प्लीज.
आई टेल यू इतने सालों में दिस इज वन फर्स्ट ओकेजन वेयर इट इज आई फील ऑनर्ड आई फील इलेटेड बाय द नेचर ऑफ डिस्कशन बाय द नेचर ऑफ न्यू इनसाइट्स बीइंग ब्रॉट इन बाय एवरीबडी. और अगर आगे से आप मुझे बाकी प्रोग्राम हो कीप मी इनफॉर्म्ड. थैंक यू सो मच सर.
श्योर विल डेफिनेटली कीप. कुमार साहब आप कुछ कहना चाहते हैं प्लीज.
कुमार साहब वांट टू से समथिंग.
कुमार साहब प्लीज.
आई जस्ट वांट टू एंडोर्स व्हाट आदित्य जी एंड मृदुला जी हैव सेड इन रिस्पांस टू पार्टली इवन रवि सिन्हास क्वेश्चन और व्हाटएवर रिस्पांस दैट ही सीक्स. आई थिंक Nehru was not only fighting the communalism and the forces of the right outside Congress, but also inside Congress. Within Congress also, there were so many right-wingers who were sympathetic to RSS. Or they may not be saying RSS as such, but they were sympathetic to the idea of, you know, soft Hindutva or whatever you call them, from Rajendra Prasad, Govind Vallappan, and so many of them. So Nehru had a very difficult situation. He had to fight within the party, within the bureaucracy. In the bureaucracy also, as you can see from the entire Ayodhya episode from 1949, how bureaucracy was sabotaging Nehru's idea. So bureaucracy as well as party within, and all those who were fighting from 1930s, you know, 1925 RSS is formed. And from then on, they have been constantly against Gandhiji. Gandhiji is not photographed anywhere going to temples, doing prarthana, doing puja. He called himself Sanatani Hindu, but he is not doing any puja, prarthana, kuch bhi nahi hai. And he says, Ishwara Allah tero naam. So Nehru understood that the attack on Gandhi is actually attack on secularism. Whether Gandhi used the term secularism or not is immaterial. But attack on Gandhi was the attack on the secular idea. And therefore, I think from then on, Pandit Nehru developed his idea, as Manoj very correctly says, the Indian version of secularism. And the point is, without understanding that Gandhi, we cannot understand Nehru, as Aditya ji very correctly said. And therefore, we have to see Gandhi, Nehru's contradictions, like Lenin's contradiction. Lenin's problem was not only outside. Lenin's problem was also with Mensheviks within. And Lenin had to fight within the party. Majority of the people in the party had opposed the idea of revolution on 25th October. Lenin had to fight. So every political leader at that level who wants to take along all the people and also the idea and conviction have to fight within the party, within the community, within the entire country, and of course without. So without and within, the enemy is all over. So I think Nehru was fighting that, and that's why I endorse just Aditya and Mruduraji completely. That's all.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
So I once again thank Professor Manoj Jha for sparing time for us, and also the presence of Kumar Ketkar Saab, Aditya Mukherjee Saab, Mruduraji, and all other stalwarts on Nehru. So many thanks all of you for joining this discussion, and we'll continue this debate discussion again, and we'll again try to invite again Prof. Jha to listen to me more about all these things. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.